Okay, the first item on the agenda is discussion on Customs Border Protection self-building.
Yes.
Go through that.
As you may recall, and a couple of years ago, Border Patrol came to us and wanted to buy fuel from Maytag. They said they could get it cheaper because they had a DESC contract and CareFlight did not. When they brought that up, in fact, coincidentally, it was like that day or within a day or two of that, the CareFlight didn't get their DESC contract and the issue went away. In October of this year, we were doing some auditing and discovered that Border Patrol had stopped buying fuel from Miller. We inquired with the interim station manager there, Mr. Weatherwax. He said, yes, that's true. He said he could get it cheaper at, from Maytag. And essentially, the conversation didn't progress much beyond that. He said he would provide me with some background information. I discussed, I talked to him again at a later time about it. Again, he's the interim director. I kind of understand he doesn't want to get into it too much. He wants a new guy to take over that question. The new guy is going to be in place here pretty soon. I believe it's important that we establish the airport's right to impose fuel flow sheets. Now, when I talked to him last time, he said, what were, Mr. Weatherwax, he said, we're self-fueling. So I looked that up in the advisory circulars, got some advice, and the any tenant has the right to perform self-fueling, but the FAA has clearly established that the airport authority has the right to monitor and manage those self-fueling operations and to impose fuel flowage fees. And so my question to the committee is, I'd like to bring this up as an issue that I think needs to be addressed. I think it needs to be addressed sooner rather than later. We need to go back to Border Patrol, get the particulars of what all is involved, because I'm not sure what all is involved, and impose the fuel flowage fees upon them and the other obligations that we have, which is to monitor their equipment, their training, the way they do it. I mean, it's a pretty long list. If you're going to have somebody fueling, even self-fueling on your airport, then you've got an obligation to see that it's being done in accordance with all the advisory circulars. And so I think we need to go through that process. But before I start down that road, I want to get guidance from the board on that. And hence, I'm bringing it up. Yes, sir.
Should, do you look to Border Patrol or do you look to Maytag?
And I don't know the answer to that question. Border Patrol is the end user, and so in my mind, it's a Border Patrol issue. They're the ones that have signed the lease, and it's their aircraft that are being flown. Now, Border Patrol, they may want...
Whose vehicles are they using?
I don't know the answer to that. I don't know if they're government. Border Patrol, all their aircraft are maintained by a contractor, and it's changed. I don't know who the current contractor is. So I don't know if it's home, if those are Border Patrol fuel trucks or contractor fuel trucks. So there's a lot of questions that, I mean, that need to be asked and answered. And I haven't asked any of those questions just yet because this is going to be a sensitive issue.
Well, it seems to me that Border Patrol is an end user. Therefore, the supplier ought to be, like Millionaire, pays the fuel for. And to me, that Maytag or contractor or somebody who's providing the service should be responsible for that or the Border Patrol.
It's our lease is with Border Patrol. Border Patrol has a responsibility to adhere to our minimum standards. We have established some basic self-fueling minimum standards or procedures in the minimum standards right now. I think that we need to go through those very carefully. And make sure that they're all inclusive. You brought up some additional points just a little while ago that maybe they need to be fleshed out a little So there's just a whole host of issues right here that needs to be looked at. But before we open the door, I just want to make sure that the board is on board with this.
Well, I agree with you. I think that the fuel choice fee should be there, but it's just, to me, who's going to pay it?
Who's going to pay?
Well, I think as a general principle, we've already accepted that the only way that we can maintain the airport financially is we have to collect that fuel storage fee wherever it is appropriate. Now, there may be agencies that it will not be appropriate from because of who they are or whatever. But anyone that fuels on the airport, you know, whether they stock fuel or whether they buy from one of their FBOs, need to collect that.
Well, the liability to us is significant. And in the case that I gave to the FAA came out and said very clearly that the airport authority, they have the right and the responsibility to check all the equipment, check the training, permit fees on the trucks. There's just, it goes on and on. And so if we're going to go down this route, we need to do it slowly and carefully to make sure we're covering all the bases.
Well, the one area that I see as a difficulty, we essentially could have two levels of self-fueling. We could have the individual pilot self-fueling who is not using the same equipment that Border Patrol is using. So we need to make sure that we take into consideration both those situations.
If an individual pilot wanted to self-fuel, it would be very difficult for him to accommodate the requirements that the FAA have laid out. It's essentially impossible. Now, they can self-service from the existing self-service pumps that are out there. But for somebody to just bring fuel in and fuel themselves, I think from a logistical standpoint, it would not be a feasible solution. And so it's important that we make it clear that we're not opening that door. If somebody wants to engage in that, they have the right to do it, but we have the right to establish our...
So you're saying that we would probably just have one set of standards that makes no difference whether you're fueling your individual aircraft, the same standards of bonds, training, equipment,
everything.
With like
just put it on. That's right.
Yeah, we need to keep that in the back of our mind. Dan?
What all does the fuel flowage fee cover? What I was looking at, though, we know that there's a liability issue, and obviously there's an administrative cost that has to be amortized into that fee. But as I understand it, that fee provides funding to assist in maintaining of the facilities. If you have a 50,000-pound vehicle driving on a ramp designed for 3,000-pound airplanes, the 3,000-pound airplane shouldn't be paying for the damage done to that ramp by a 50,000-pound vehicle. That's what part of that fee is to offset. Am I correct in that?
That's correct.
Okay, so if we were to look at all of the expenses that fuel flowage fee per gallon is attempting to cover, I think we could better understand what the burden is and why. If the Border Patrol was over on the Marine side, okay. The Maytagger vehicles are on the Marine side. The Marine side is responsible for their payment. But on this side, that Marine contractor is not responsible for our payment. How do we cover that payment? How do we protect that property investment, which in the long run belongs to the taxpayer, under our jurisdiction or our oversight? I just don't see how you could have, I mean, when a C-130 flies for NASA and they buy fuel from Millionaire, they're paying that fee.
Right.
So I don't see why the Border Patrol would think that, okay, then fly your airplane over there and get fuel, but you can't do it over here because there's an expense relative to the taxpayer that needs to be covered.
Right.
Am I wrong on that?
And the 22 cents was initially set because that essentially worked out to be the per gallon price that the lease from the FBO's ramp fees used to cover. In other words, the FBO's paid to lease the ramp $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
We decided that wasn't going to work anymore, and so we simply divided the number of gallons by those dollars, came up at 22 cents, and said, for better or worse, 22 cents a gallon is going to be there.
And that's 22 cents
for everyone.
For how long?
Except the airlines, which get 5 cents.
10 cents.
Is it 10 cents? Okay, 10 cents.
Yeah. And so our initial, in fact, our initial number was wrong. Because we, you know, we said 22 cents because we assumed 22 cents across the board.
Yeah.
And then right off the top of that, about, I don't know, a third of it, you know, we had dropped to 10 cents. But we already established that, so we just we stuck with it. So if we were to go back and recalculate it, it would be significantly higher. But
well, and I think the other thing that works in our favor a little bit is the 22 cents may have been low at the time, but as fuel price goes up, and then we recover more dollars.
True, but at the same time, our expenses are going up.
What expenses? Yeah. Let's not think about it. You had a comment, team?
No,
the letter that you have in here, I like the letter. When have you seen the letter that Craig is going to send to the Board of Control?
Yeah.
I mean, as long as you like the letter, right? Because you're dealing with government.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to get crossways, but still, I think it's fair. We're entitled to that 22 cents someplace.
Right.
And the bottom line is if the fee is for everybody, and so it's equal across the board, and it covers an actual expense that's incurred as overhead,
mm-hmm.
okay, and it's capturable, and you can see where the money's going. Then the only question is whether or not, because of some reason, Border Control has some other type of federal caveat, you're going to investigate that with the staff and come back and let us know.
That's right.
So unless there's some issue
with the
legal regulation that we're aware of, everybody's treated the same.
Well, I think the other thing that we also have to remember, Ewing sleep comes up, because any non-flying aircraft was considered to be a liability to the airport in the sense that it was not paying any fees whatsoever under any conditions. There were no tie-down fees, it's not using any fuel, and therefore it's not producing any revenue, but it is occupying space.
And which it's exposing the airfield to liability, too.
Yeah, I think there's that issue. So most of the non-flying aircraft have been taken care of in one way or another. Mr. Ewing's aircraft were all moved down on the southern end of the ramp and kind of covered with a blanket lease payment. Mainly, I think, in consideration of the fact that he was trying to sell those aircraft. He wrote them. He had been a long-time tenant in an important part of the airport. And so we had done some consideration in trying to sort of aid and abet him getting rid of those. And I think the letter that has gone out to Mr. Ewing, I think I sparked that when I went to Mr. Williams and said, there's four or five of Ewing's aircraft that are parked in unusable parts of the ramp, Paris Light Ramp and by Garza's maintenance hangar. And they're taking up a considerable amount of room. They're non-flying aircraft. I think one of them may be a flying aircraft.
Yeah, and I'll let to respond to your question there. We sent a letter. His last lease option expired March 31st. We just haven't had a chance to get back around to him. And so I sent him a letter acknowledging that his lease expired March 31st, but that we have coordinated. And so I'm extending him, you know, month to month until we catch up and then address that problem.
Yeah. And I think that's a reasonable thing for us to do. And I would like to see those non-flying aircraft that just consolidated back in the ramp. Right now, during the summer, we don't have really much of an issue for ramp space, but the day will come when we do.
Sure.
And so as a general principle, we should make sure we're taking care of non-flying aircraft. And most of them, for years, we had a bunch of them over on Beko's ramp. Flat tires, planes that had never flown and maybe never would. We all remember the Utah National Guard plane that had pieces falling off of it. Sometimes people would walk by with their rope and tie things back up so they didn't blow away. But so we need to take care of those issues. Okay, so I think the committee is in favor of continuing the negotiations with the
Getting back to Mr. Rice's question about the letter, what came out here today is that there's a lot of information that needs to be added yet. It may be appropriate before this letter came out, an inquiry you made as to the status?
Well, I've made inquiries, two verbal inquiries to CBP, and not really gotten much back. And I don't have any harp on that. I mean, Mr. Weatherwax is a good guy. He's an interim guy, and he doesn't, I mean, I understand, you know, let's let the new guy get in here. I hate, okay, the new guy here, you know, welcome, you know, like that. But I don't really feel like I can make any inquiries, and maybe we just need to change the letter. But I think the letter is intended to, you know, open the conversation like this, according to us, this is what you owe. Now, if you know something different, let's talk. And that would be kind of be my opening. But that's, we can change that however you feel appropriate. But I need, before I open this up officially, I'd like guidance from the board to, go ahead and move forward.
Do you have a consensus on that issue?
Yeah.
We should.
Recommendation.
Make sure to explore that in whatever reasonable way you can.
Well, what I'd like is for the strategy committee to make a recommendation to the board. The board say, yes, go ahead and do this.
Okay, I think we can do that.
This meeting.
Williams, go ahead and move forward.
Just get out of the way and stay back.